Austin, Texas. I'm just going to sing one for you. No, I'm not. Austin, Texas, this is your moment. Please give a very warm South by Southwest welcome to Dolly Parton.
Trouble, trapped amongst the trash and rubble, praying for relief but getting none. You wanna start your life anew, you just don't know exactly how to find your opportunity and run. Run, run and run some more, clear the premises before the same old problems pull you back again. Run, run and just keep going till you get to where you're knowing you can rest, catch your breath, know how. You'll find a way. Refuse to be controlled by anyone. And the walls that you run into, break them down. You know you have two choices. You can stay or run. Run, run, and just keep moving. Heal the past, keep improving. You can face your troubles one by one. You're gonna have to face your problems. You need time and space to solve them. Then you'll bloom just like a rose, kissed by. Take your chances, you can do it. Make a plan and then stick to it. Make a choice to really be someone. Break away, run to freedom. Break old habits, you don't need them. Break the cycle, those old days are done. You have two choices, you can stay. Keep going till you get to where you're knowing. You can rest and catch your breath. I know that you can win. So run, 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 run. Come on. Run, 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 run.
Your show running, you're gonna be completely out of breath. Anyway, it is good to be with you again, and I have really enjoyed working with James, as I mentioned, and that's the title song, of course, of the album and the book. Should have made him sing with me, but he can't sing. I told you that. No, but he can certainly write, and he's a good guy. And I do love a lot of the songs that's in the album. And it was fun working with the characters. And I thought, well, as we mentioned a while ago, I thought, I need to write some songs. I need a country album out anyhow, some good bluegrass stuff. So I thought, well, I'll just pick some ideas how the book. And I did. And this is one of them. And it goes like this.
Is it easy? No, it ain't. Can I fix it? No, I can't. But I sure ain't gonna take it lying down. Will I make it? Maybe so. Will I give up? Oh, no. I'll be fighting till I'm 6 feet underground. surrender. No, I won't. It's a long, hard life for a gal, but I gotta live it. And it's a dang shame if you ask me, working so hard just to be free. Whatever it takes, and I'm more than glad to give it. So I'm gonna warm it up and take it like a man. Gotta buckle up, be tough enough to give him hell and take command. Soft like a woman, strong like a man. Stick to my guns and have a plan. Gotta warm it up and take it like a man. Rough road, we'll walk it. Never give up, we'll talk it. Soon enough, we can talk it. Up to experience and paying dues, and I'll speak my truth. Sing it, girl. Woman, I've been taking like a man. And I'm gonna buckle up, be tough enough to take control and make demands. Look like a woman, think like a man. Be as good as or better than.
Any sign, that's going to be a good one off the album. Well, of course, I wrote that for all us girls, but I bet you old hairy-legged boys kind of liked it too, didn't you? Yeah, good. Because we love our men. I've been married to the same one for 56 years now. I'm trying to catch my breath. Speaking of a good-looking man, here comes one now. Is my hair still on? That is Steve Summers. That's the guy that James was talking about that designed his clothes and mine. Anyway, he's a good guy. He traveled with us. I love you too, but I told you to wait in the truck. Texas, or on your horse, either one. Anyway, this is another one of the songs from the new album, and I told you that I'd be singing a few, but this one kind of sums up every dream or every person that wants to go to Nashville, whether you're from Texas or whether you're from Tennessee or wherever you're from. You head out chasing a dream. And most of the ones that head to Nashville are wearing their faded jeans with their big dreams. So hope you like this song by that name, Big Dreams and Faded Jeans.
Put on my jeans, my favorite shirt, pull up my boots and hit the dirt. Finally doing something I've dreamed of for years. Don't know quite what to expect. A little scared, but what the heck. My desire is always greater than my fear. Big dreams and faded jeans fit together like a team. Always busting at the seams. Big dreams and faded jeans. Just my own guitar and me. Out to find my destiny. Nashville is the place to be. For big dreams and faded jeans. Put out my thumb and wish for luck to hitch a car, a semi-truck. Sooner or later, one will catch me in their field. seems, big dreams and faded jeans. Like the song Bobby McGee's, I'm just longing to be free. Take me where I wanna be, big dreams and faded jeans. And there are many just like me with big dreams.
The new songs, and hopefully you'll be hearing them down through the years. Of course, I know a lot of you have been on my side for more years than any of us can count, and I want you to know that I have appreciated every year you've spent with me throughout my career. Of course, I did go to Nashville. I moved there when I was 18. I graduated on a Friday night, hopped a bus. On a Saturday morning, I had went out with my matching luggage, four bags from the same grocery store, had all my little clothes in there, got to Nashville, and I thought, well, I'd left two boyfriends back home. And only two. But I had decided that I didn't want a boyfriend at that time because I thought I didn't want anybody messing up my career, because I had dreams. I had big dreams and faded jeans. So what do? I take those little dirty clothes that I brought from home, and I went down to the laundromat down from this little apartment where I was going to be staying. And this good-looking guy pulled up and spoke to me, and me, like a hillbilly, I took him home. Well, anyhow, I met him, and we got married 2 years later. And I was trying to make it in the business, and I knew that neither one of us had much money. My husband was in the asphalt paving business. He and his daddy had a home-owned, home-operated business. And so Carl kept going down to, my husband's name was Carl Dean, so he kept going down to the bank. And I thought, why is he spending so much time at the bank? I know we ain't got that kind of money yet. So one day, I thought, I was pretending like I was going to the bank. So I went in there, and he was sitting in there on a desk, this beautiful, red-headed, long-legged girl. And I thought, what is he doing in there? So I kind of casually walked in. I said, hey, I didn't know you was here. I said, what are you doing in here? He said, well, I'm talking to her. I'm trying to get a loan for a roller for his asphalt paving. I said, oh, you are? Don't you think you might have talked to some of those hairy-legged boys about a roller for your asphalt paving company? I said, you better get to the house, or it is going to be your ass and your fault. So I wrote the song, Jolene. You remember her? Over her, though, she made me a lot of money.
Jolene, 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 I'm begging of you, please don't take my name. Jolene, 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 please don't take him just because you can. Your beauty is beyond compare, with flaming locks of auburn hair, with ivory skin and eyes of emerald green. Your smile is like a breath of spring, your voice is soft like summer rain. I cannot compete with you, Jolene. He talks about you in his sleep. There's nothing I can do to keep from crying when he calls. Mm-hmm. can easily understand how you can easily take my man, but you don't know what he means to me, Joe.
Jolene or a Jolene somewhere. Somebody's trying to steal somebody you love. That kind of hurts. But anyway, my life was good back then. My career was moving along. And always when I moved to Nashville, I really missed my family because I grew up in a family of 12 kids, six boys and six girls in our family. And I had never slept in a bed by myself till I left home because we always slept two and three in a bed, and that wasn't so bad, but all the kids peed in the bed, and they, but that's family. But when you're that far away from home, and you're that homesick, you'd be surprised how you miss stuff like pee, and toenails digging into your shin bones, trying to get comfortable in your bed. But anyhow, I loved my family, and I started writing songs about them too. But anyhow, thinking about my precious memories and how I grew up, See, I grew up in my grandpa's church, and there's a little place called the House of Prayer, my mama's daddy, my grandpa, and so he used to teach us how to sing and tell us stories, how Jesus loved us, and how through God all things are possible, and I still believe that today, and I'm glad I grew up like that. But anyhow, I was thinking about that one day, and when I was writing some of my country songs and my songs about home. I just thought of that little church, though, and that was really my foundation. So I'm sure we all have precious memories of our childhood. So, and there's a great old song that we used to sing in Grandpa's church, and it was called Precious Memories, and it goes like this.
Precious memories, unseen angels, sent from somewhere to my soul. How they linger ever near me. Precious sacred scenes unfold. Precious Father, loving mother, fly across the lonely years. And those old home scenes of my childhood, in fond memory appears. Pray. soul in the stillness of the midnight. Precious, sacred scenes unfold. Precious memories.
Thank you. I'll be back. That was real water back there, not Lone Star beer. Anyway, seriously, I think a lot about my growing up days. And my grandpa, you know, as I mentioned, he was a preacher. So when I was started very young. In fact, my mama's people were all very musical. But ever since I was tiny, I remember I used to take a tobacco stick and I would put it down in the crack on the floor of our porch out front in our old shack. I put a tin can on top and I pretend like that was my microphone. So it was always my dream to be a star. I was singing to the chickens and the ducks and the little kids in the yard, the ones that didn't crawl away or walk off from me. But I was practicing, and I'd go to church all the time. And, of course, I started singing on radio and television when I was very young, local. My Uncle Bill used to take me around because he thought I had something special. And so he would take me around to sing. But my grandpa, I wanted to start wearing makeup, you know, because the lady that I patterned the way I look from, she was a woman downtown, and they called her, she was, a loose woman, or a tramp, or a trollop, or a lot of names for her. But anyway, every once in a while, we'd get to go to town with Daddy and Mama if they had business at the courthouse or something. So every now and again, we'd just pile in Daddy's pickup truck, and we'd go to town. So I would always see this woman, you know, walking up and down the streets. And I thought she was the prettiest thing I'd ever seen. She had this big, you know, high, peroxided hair, red fingernails, high heel shoes with little plastic goldfish in them. And when she walked, they looked like they're swimming. Her little tight skirt, she'd go down the street just walking. And of course, all the men be whistling at her, and all the women were jealous. And so I just thought she was the prettiest thing I'd ever seen. I was just little then. And I remember Mama coming out of the courthouse. I said, Mama, ain't she pretty? Mama said, oh, honey, she ain't nothing but trash. And I thought, aha, that's what I'm going to be when I grow up. I thought it meant how I looked. So, getting back to my grandpa. So I started wanting to have that look sooner than I should have. So, and when I got to be like 12 or 13, I wanted to wear makeup and stuff and fix my hair and you know, peroxide my hair, and so I did. I got in trouble with it, but my grandpa kept saying, honey, you've just got to get that makeup off of you. Don't you want to go to heaven? I said, well, yeah, I do, Grandpa, but do I have to look like hell to get there? So, but my grandpa loved me now. You got to understand, our church was a very strict church. It was a holy roller church, Pentecostal. And they didn't even, you know, they didn't think a woman should shave her legs or pluck her eyebrows. So that's why you see all those holy roller women, you know, wearing those hairdos, those bangs, and those long skirts. That's to cover those bushy eyebrows and those hairy legs. It's like, anyway, I couldn't imagine that I had to look like that. So anyway, my grandpa was special to me, and I always like to tell the story, but I did later write a song about Grandpa, and he believed I was going to heaven when I wrote a song called Daddy Was an Old-Time Preacher Man, and it became a hit. So I was okay with my grandpa, but seriously, it was in that little church, getting back to more serious things, that I really learned to be anchored and know that you needed some faith to get by in this world. And of course, Mom and Daddy were very special. My daddy was a great and wonderful man. Daddy couldn't read and write, but he was one of the smartest people I've ever known, and he's the one that inspired me to start my imagination library, where we give books to children around the world. But in there, yeah, thank you. I'm real proud of that program. But anyway, when things were really getting rough for us and the family was beginning to multiply, well, a lot of men, a lot of people from the South were going up to Detroit, Michigan, and to the big cities to work. Well, some of my uncles and some of, you know, our relatives were going, and Daddy never had been out of the Smoky Mountains, but a couple of his brothers said, Lee, you need to get up here and get a job, get enough money to get Abby Lee and them kids out of that damn holler. So Daddy thought, well, that's true. We do need more than what we got. So Daddy went up there with him. He lasted about 2 weeks. And he said, because he couldn't read the signs, he couldn't drive, you know, it was like one of those he couldn't, he was just helpless with it. Plus, he was missing Mama and all those little stringy-headed, snotty-nosed kids. And so he said, I'm going back to the Smoky Mountains. I'm going to raise my kids the best way I know how. And Daddy never left again. But it inspired me to write this song about people like Daddy when they go off leaving family to try to make a living. And this is called Smoky Mountain Memories.
You ought to go north, somebody told us, 'cause the air is filled with gold dust, and fortune falls like snowflakes in your hands. Now, I don't recall who said it, but we'd spent our lives on credit, so we just headed out to find our promised land. Just poor Appalachian farm folk with nothing more than high hopes. So we hitched our station wagon to a star. But our dreams all fell in on us, 'cause there was no land promised. Lord, it's a struggle just keeping sight of who you are. Oh, and these northern nights are dreary, and my southern heart is weary as I wonder how the old folks are back home. But I keep leaning on my Jesus to Smoky Mountain memories keep me strong. You know, I've been thinking just a whole lot lately about what's been and what awaits me. It takes all I've got to give what life demands. Lord, you go insane if you give in to it. Life's a meal, and brother, I've been through it. I'm just grateful I'm creative with my hands. Oh, and these northern nights, they're dreary. These old southern eyes grow teary as I wonder how the old folks are back home. But me, I'm leaning on my Jesus. I know he'll love and guide, and he'll lead us. Smoky Mountain memories keep me strong. If I keep looking to the Father, he'll keep my head. Smoky Mountain memories keep me strong.
keep me strong. Oh, thank you. Well, I talked about Grandpa. I talked about Daddy. And now I'm going to talk about my mama. Now, you know as well as I do, if you're lucky enough to have a good mom and daddy, that's the best gift that God can ever bestow on you. And certainly a good mama. Now, mama was a very special person. She just had a way of telling you anything, making it sound good, cook anything, and make it taste good. She could go through the house when you think there wasn't a thing to eat in the house. She'd just open a cabinet and a drawer and this and that before you knew it. Mama would have something special out there. And she used to do what she called, she used to make that stone soup. You ever hear the legend of the stone soup? Well, Mama, what Mama used to do with that big bunch of kids, and we didn't have that much, Mama tried to make us all feel special and make us a part of everything because she loved us all the same. But she was very in tune to every one of us. So she would make us, when she'd say, we'd say, Mama, make some stone soup. So she said, well, you just get out there in that yard and pick me up some good rocks. So we'd all go out, we'd go down to the creek, and we'd all just be knocking each other in the head and everything, trying to get the best rocks, you know, because we wanted Mama to pick our rock. So anyway, she said, well, now, you just go wash them off now and just lay them across the porch there, and I'll decide which one that I'm going to put in that soup. So we would, and we'd just wait around, and Mama always knew when one of us might be going through a hard time. Maybe we'd been sick or been in trouble or whatever. So Mama would pick that rock. She'd say, she'd go around like she was really examining every one of them, and she'd think, I think this is the one that's going to make that soup good. And I just remember we all, when she'd pick our rock, we felt like we'd helped feed the family for a day, and that was real special. But Mama also was great about sewing things, because people would bring us big boxes and bags of rags and scraps, because they knew Mama had a bunch of kids, and she made all the curtains for our windows and the bedspreads and made our clothes and remade them. So one time, Mama had a bunch of rags. I needed a little coat to wear to school. So Mama made me a famous little coat. We didn't know it was going to be famous then, but it goes like this, and it's a true story. So we'll dedicate it to all the good mamas out there.
Back through the years, I go wandering once again. Back to the seasons of my youth. And I recall a box of rags someone gave us. And how my mama put the rags to use. There were rags of many colors, but every piece was small. And I didn't have a coat, and it was way down in the fall. Mama sewed the rags together, sewing every piece with love. She made my coat of many colors that I was so proud of. While Mama sewed, she told a story from the Bible she had read about a coat of many colors Joseph wore. And then she said, I hope this coat will bring you good luck and happiness. And I just couldn't wait to wear it, and Mama blessed it with a kiss. My coat of many colors that my Mama made for me, made only proudly. And although we had no money, I was rich as I could be. In my coat of many colors Mama made for me. So with patches on my breeches, holes in both my shoes, in my coat of many colors I hurried off to school, just to find the others laughing and making fun of me. In my coat of many colors Mama made for me. And oh, I couldn't understand that, 'cause I felt I was rich. And I told them of the love Mama sewed in every stitch. I even told him all that story. Mama told me while she sewed and why my coat of many colors was worth more than all their clothes. They didn't understand it, and I tried to make them see. One is only poor, only if they choose to be. It's true we had no money, but I was rich as I could be. In my coat of many colors, Mama made for me, 'cause she made.
So much. I'm sure a lot of people can relate to that little song. In fact, I carried that hurt around with me for years, and I didn't realize it was in there. And just one day, I started writing that song, and then it became a big hit, and that hurt left me just like that. Ain't it amazing how healing money can be? You know I'm joking. I wouldn't take nothing for that, but I did give my mama the royalties from that little song for years and years and years. Anyway, life went on, and again, I'm back in Nashville, and I was working with the Porter Wagoner Show for years. Some of you might remember that. Some of you are too young, but I worked with a man that had the number one television show for years, and I didn't want to just stay being a girl singer in somebody's group, because my dream had always been to go out on my own and, you know, have my own band, and I still had them big dreams. And even though my jeans weren't as faded, I still had the same big dreams of going on and doing other things. So I was going to leave the show, and I was looking for new management and record label, and a lot of people were saying, you know what, you don't need to be leaving country music. I said, I'm not leaving country music. I'm too country for that. I'll take country with me wherever I go, but I want to see what all I can do. I want to do some other things. So everybody said, it's a big mistake, Dolly. It's a big mistake. So I left anyway, and I was just praying, Lord, please let my first record be a hit, because I don't want to have to deal with that, everybody being right about that. So I found a great song, and it just so happened it was my very first million-selling record. You remember Here You Come Again? Okay, well, let's do that.
Here you come again, just when I've begun to get myself together. You walks right in the door, just like you've done before, and you wrap my heart round your little finger. Here you come again, just when I'm about to make it work without you. You look into my eyes and lie those pretty lies, till pretty soon I'm wondering how I came to doubt you. All you gotta do is smile that smile, and there go all my defenses. Just leave it up to you, and in a little while, you're messing up my mind, filling up my senses. Here you come again. Oh, and looking better than a body has a right to, and shaking me up so that all I really know is here you come again. And here I go. Shaking me up so
Some of you have been out working a 9-to-5 job, ain't you?
Stumble to the kitchen, pour myself a cup of ambition, yawn and stretch and try to come to life. I jump in the shower and the blood starts pumping. Out on the street, the traffic starts jumping with folks like me on the job from 9 to 5. Yeah, working 9 to 5. What a way to make a living, barely getting by. It's all taking and no giving. They just use your mind and they never give you credit. It's enough to drive you crazy if you let it. 9 to 5, for service and devotion. You would think that I would deserve a fair promotion. I want to move ahead, but the boss won't seem to let me. I swear sometimes that man is out to get me. To watch them shatter, you're just a step on the boss man's ladder, but you got dreams he'll never take away. You're in the same boat with a lot of your friends, waiting for the day your ship will come in. Tide's gonna turn and it's all gonna roll your way. I just know it. Working 9 to 5, what a way to make a living, barely getting by. It's all taking and no giving. They just use your mind.
Working 9 to 5, what a way to make
living,
barely
getting by.
It's all
taking and no giving.
They just
use your mind
and they never give you credit. It's
enough to drive you crazy if you let it.
Oh boy, you really dug in there on that crazy part, didn't you? Well, thank you. That's usually my leaving song, but you knew good and well I wasn't going to leave right now. Because I forgot to sing our favorite song. The one that says that I will always love you. Because I will. I really appreciate all of you. And I have had a good time here tonight. And this little song has meant so much to so many people. And it means a lot to me. And I want to dedicate it especially to you tonight and to thank you again for being wonderful.
Would only be in your way. so I'll go. But I know I'll think of you each step of the way. And favorite shirt, pull up my boots and hit the dirt.